background as well as starting shopping for a Nintendo game and starting that your dad picking up a piano instead on that same day, right?
Right.
And then doing your little entrepreneurship as well as selling the donuts and stuff for $300, right?
Right.
So you're a rich man off of that. But Nicholas, I want to get to your education. Give me a little background on you. You mentioned that you were homeschooled.
I was. I went back and forth between traditional schooling and homeschooling. And we moved around quite a bit within Los Angeles and then up into Oregon for a little while. When I came back to L.A. after a few years in Oregon, I went to Hamilton High School Academy of Music.
Where's Hamilton?
It's on Robertson in downtown. Yeah.
Yeah.
In West L.A.
Yeah. I got a lot of minute music program really stepped up there.
It's a really big music program. So I was there for 2 years. But I felt that because of the commute and the fact that I had to take the bus and the amount of homework that I was losing time for practicing. So after my second year, I took the California High School Proficiency Exam and I finished high school in my junior year.
Mm-hmm.
And I spent the next 2 years practicing, preparing for my college auditions, performing and doing competitions.
Now, doing the homeschooling thing, did you find that an advantage for woodshedding and your accomplishments versus just being in regular school?
Definitely.
Yeah. How about some of your influences as your dad took you around? And I mean, that's a big difference, man, to go shopping for a Nintendo game and wound up with a piano.
Well, I don't really remember that. I mean, I was three, and I expect that I was probably a little bit upset, but I probably liked the piano also.
Well, I mean, so Dad, you could say he was probably your biggest influence, and Mom as well. Mom is here today, by the way. Hi, Mom.
No, definitely. They've been so supportive. I mean, without them, I wouldn't have started, and there have been times where I would have stopped, and they've always supported me through everything.
Mm-hmm. Your broadcast on NPR, and you were 18 years old, and what piece was that? Did you do a Beethoven piece?
I did, the first movement of Beethoven's Sonata.
Amazing. Fantastic.
Thank you.
I mean, we were talking about this, ladies, folks, before we came on air, and his accuracy and touch is just amazing. So if you get a chance, please pull up NicholasKingPiano.com at any time and just watch this young man play. He's an incredible player. Then I pulled up the duet. And as I said earlier, it was like night and day. I mean, just your technique had changed so much. What did you do to...
I practiced a lot.
we know you're practicing, but what? Speaking of practicing, what did you do? Eight hours a day? 9 hours a day?
Well, I started university. I mean, the NPR broadcast was the summer right before I started my first year of school in Toronto.
Mm-hmm.
And the time that I performed at The Other Pianist, the performance you were talking about, that was 4 years into my undergrad. It was my last year of undergrad. So I had practiced so much and learned so much from my new teacher there and gained so much from performing and learning from other musicians that I really felt that I improved. It was a really good school and a really good time for me.
Nicholas, when did you know, man? I mean, when did you know you were going to take this really seriously, being a concert pianist?
You know what? It's something that I always knew I wanted to do. But I guess when I was young, I was a little arrogant about it, and I just thought, oh, well, this is something I'll definitely do, and I wasn't really aware of the amount of work that would go into it. And then maybe around my early teens, I really had an idea of, you know, the amount of work this was going to take. But it's always something I've been passionate about.
Mm-hmm. I mean, Jesus. Anyway, you performed at Carnegie Hall, most recently the Walt Disney Center, right?
Right.
Yeah. What did you think?
It's an amazing hall. It's the best piano I've ever played on. The acoustics were phenomenal. I mean, it was kind of intimidating going to perform in Disney Hall because I grew up in L.A. and I saw Disney Hall being built.
Yeah.
And I went and I saw some of the best concerts I've ever seen there with amazing artists. And to know that I shared the stage with them was, you know, it was terrifying. But
how about Carnegie?
The same thing.
Really?
Yeah.
I played Carnegie. But not as in a classical perspective. It was a R&B thing. I guess it was the Pointer Sisters back in the early 80s. And, you know, one thing I really appreciate when you're doing concerts in big halls is I can actually hear myself, the percussion coming off the back wall. And
definitely.
I find that it just...
makes such a big difference.
Yeah, so you know what I mean. When you that was my next question to you. When you're in the hall,
mm-hmm.
and you're playing, And you could hear that sound coming all through the venue. What does that take you to?
Well, it's something really hard to adjust to, because so often we're in pianists are in practice rooms that are like little prison cells. You know, they don't have any windows, and they have like a door that has a big deadbolt on it, and there's nothing inspiring on the walls, and sometimes the piano is all beat up and broken. But then when you finally get a chance to go into the hall, you know, it's usually only the day before, and you have to learn to adjust really quickly. But it's so nice, because you have this idea in your head when you're practicing of what you want things to sound like. And finally, when you have the instrument that you're able to do these things on, and in a hall where you're able to express it, it makes the biggest difference.
Okay, let's get to some of your awards here. You got an award from Glenn Gould?
I did.
Are you familiar with Glenn?
I am. I got an award from the Glenn Gould School, and that's where I did my undergraduate studies.
Well, you know, I did a little research on him. I know Jan Paderewski. I remember that name. At least I guess college did something for him. I can actually remember that. But he was not so much of a fan of any other music. Are you aware of that? I mean,
Glenn Gould?
Yeah.
He was so eccentric.
Yeah.
He was really, really strange.
Yeah.
I think he sued someone for shaking his hand too hard.
Really?
Yeah.
How do you feel about that? I mean,
people shake my hand too hard?
Yeah.
I don't like it so much.
Yeah, because, I mean, before we were talking, and I said, well, maybe I'll have a keyboard in here for you to play. What is the thing with a classical pianist not wanting to touch an electric piano?
You know what? I think it's that the music was written specifically for the instrument, and when you go from an acoustic piano to an electric keyboard, you lose so much in the nuances, and it's a lot harder to control. I mean, I did a little bit of jazz music at Hamilton, and I don't consider myself a jazz musician at all. I mean, it's great and I love it, but I'm not. It's not something I'm very comfortable with. But I found that the particular instrument didn't matter so much. But in classical music, there's so much sensitivity and again, like the way that you completed this phrase or the touch or the articulation for a particular note, that if you go onto an electric instrument, it's so far ahead of when it was written that it just doesn't translate.
Interesting. Now back to the awards here. As Glenn Gould, you said, what did you get, like a scholarship of 10, 15 grand out of that?
So the Glenn Gould School, it's a school just like Juilliard or Curtis or Peabody. I mean, it's a small conservatory that has about 120 students. And I did my undergrad there. Every year they have a competition within all the students. Mm-hmm. And the students ranging from ages, I think, 18 to 26, 27. And we all compete for a chance to play with the orchestra.
Nicholas, where is the school?
In Toronto.
Oh, it's up in Canada.
Right.
Oh, okay. And how about the Paderewski? Was that just a scholarship, or was that?
No, the Paderewski was no. It was also a competition that was held at Colburn here in downtown LA.
See, I know Paderewski. I mean, I remember in college, but I guess I'm more familiar with his winery up in Napa Valley, the Paderewski Winery.
Oh, I'm not familiar with it.
Really?
Uh-huh.
Yeah, it's the same guy.
Really?
Yeah, but he was born in 1919, right? So he's obviously no longer here, but yeah, they have a winery up there.
Really?
Yeah, Napa Valley, man.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, it's kind of interesting. So, did you go over to Poland?
I did. I performed in Poland.
Whoa. By yourself? You did a concert, a single concert?
I performed with an orchestra in Poland.
You did?
Yeah.
Oh, I thought you just went to do the scholarship, man. That's fantastic.
Yeah, it was great. I mean, it was a result of the Paderewski competition. The prize that I won allowed me to fly to Poland and perform with as a soloist with an orchestra there. And it was amazing. I mean, the place where we rehearsed and stayed was in a town called Ostromeco. And it was in a palace that they had refurbished to make into sort of like a hotel.
Uh-huh.
So we stayed in like these palatial bedrooms. It was amazing. And then downstairs in the grand ballroom, that's where we rehearsed with the orchestra. And we performed in a city not too far from there, in Bydgoszcz.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Oh my God. What about Dublin, Ireland?
Dublin was great. I was fortunate enough to stay with the composer of Riverdance, Bill Whelan.
Really?
It's a really big competition, the Dublin International Piano Competition, and it happens every 3 years. So I was fortunate enough to be chosen to go. So I went and I stayed. They put us up with host families if you're not from the city, and most of the contestants aren't. So I stayed in Bill Whelan's house, and he was very kind, and I stayed with another competitor from Russia. And it was just such a whirlwind experience. I mean, they had, I think, about 300 or 400 applicants to get into the competition. Mm-hmm. They select 40 to get into the competition, then they slowly whittle them away, half and half and half.
Not all piano, but...
All piano.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, amazing, man. And congratulations on these awards, by the way, because you got the Teachers Association Scholarship as well,
mm-hmm.
from Berkeley?
Yeah.
Did you go up there?
No.
Or back there?
No, I haven't.
Oh, okay. How about the Royal Conservatory of Music?
That was that one's connected to the Glenn Gould School.
That's, oh, it is.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, okay, Toronto, that one.
Right.
So why did you go to school there, not to CalArts or?
Well, what I did was I applied to the biggest name schools in North America.
Mm-hmm.
So Peabody, for specifically for classical piano. So Peabody, Cleveland Institute of Music, Juilliard, the Royal Conservatory, the Glenn Gould School, which is a bit smaller, but it's still a very, very good school, Oberlin. And then what I did was of the schools that I got into, I went and I had a lesson with each of the teachers, because it's nice to have a really prestigious school on your resume, but when it comes down to it, the most important thing is the teacher that you had and the education you got.
Right.
I mean, to go to a great school and not have such a great teacher, it isn't so beneficial in the long run. So of all the teachers that I worked with, I found that Mark Durand in Toronto was the most helpful. And I like to think that I made the right decision. I mean, he's been incredibly helpful, and it was a really good experience.
You know, as I talk to you, you're very articulate. And obviously, you said you're 21, 22 now?
22.
Yeah, do you agree that traveling eliminates a lot of ignorance? I mean, you're exposed to different cultures, and in other words, you're very seasoned to be so young. You know?
Thank you. Yes. Thank you. No, I think it's really humbling traveling and then seeing so many different people, especially in music. You know, you might think that you're good in one environment, and then you fly somewhere else, and you hear somebody else that's been practicing in a different way, and you think, oh, well, actually, I might not be as good as I thought.
Well, you're damn good to me, my man. Nicholas, how do you feel about today's music?
In what you mean, like contemporary pop music?
Well, yeah, pop music. Just before we came on air, Felicia was playing. Who were you playing?
Jamie Foxx.
Yeah, Jamie Foxx, Alcohol. So, what do you think about some of the music, the way it's recorded, performed today, outside of classical music?
I don't listen. I know some people that only listen to classical music, and, mm-hmm. I think that's kind of a shame, because I think you can have really appreciate great music in every genre. I feel like a lot of contemporary pop music, like a lot of the top 40 hits, they change so often, and you'll hear about them for a few weeks and then never again. And I think that they don't necessarily have longevity. You know, they're kind of something sometimes lacking depth in order to be really accessible by everyone. Not that, you know, great music has to be extremely deep, but I find that some contemporary pop music specifically lacks the depth that I enjoy.
You know what, a few weeks ago I had Ron Ellison on, which was a big executive back in the 50s and 70s, and we kind of hit on that point, and he saw the music business change, mm-hmm. and his point was that since the corporations have stepped in and bought all the record companies, you see the difference in no longevity. They just like get
right.
in his window and push him out.
Right.
You know, with that said, what would you tell a young inspiring musician to come up now? You got all the stuff going, you got Michael Jordan shoes, everything, the digital age is coming up, everything is moving so fast. Most kids don't want to sit there and practice 8-9 hours a day.
Right, right.
You know, so what can you tell them that would...
You know, one thing that really helped me was everybody struggles with practicing. Like, it isn't that it's super easy for me, and it's not something I struggle with. Everybody I know always, throughout their life, struggles with practicing in one way or another.
Mm-hmm.
But I think, you're right, everything is moving so fast, and we always have our iPhones and Facebook and our computer on and MTV, and everything is happening. And I think it's really important to slow down when you can. One of the things I did my second year in university was I killed my Facebook, and I found that I was spending so much time on my computer, my laptop at home, that I just put it in my locker at school, not to be completely antisocial, but just when I came home to kind of slow down a bit and kind of have time for myself. And I found that having that mental space to kind of breathe
yeah.
made the biggest difference in the practice room, because I think the hard thing is that, like I said, it's a prison cell. You're in there by yourself. There's no flashing lights. You're not interacting with anyone. You're by yourself with this piece of wood with strings.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that if your mind is so quick to move, so used to moving so quickly, that to shift to going to a room where there's no screen and nothing happening instantaneously, it's too extreme. So I think just finding a balance where you're able to just be a little bit more neutral and move at a more normal pace, it will make that transition easier.
Now, were you thinking about the money?
In what sense?
Fame of being a concert pianist? I mean, because when we're talking about moving so fast now, most of these kids are thinking about a payday.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So.
No, you know, as a classical pianist, I really didn't think about the money. You know, you don't get into it for the money. Definitely not.
Right.
You know, the people that have these big stellar careers, there are about, you know, what, 10 of them across the world. For classical, I mean, there might be a little bit more, but it's definitely you do it because you love it, not because you expect a big monetary payout.
Mm-hmm. Well, Nicholas, I have a surprise for you today.
Okay.
And I didn't tell anyone about this, but I brought this for you.
Thank you.
And we're going to play a little bit because I couldn't get Nicholas to bring his piano in the studio today because it's too big. But Nicholas and I are going to play together just briefly.
All right. So what are these?
Those are called kashishis.
Kashishis.
Those are actually an African instrument made popular down in Brazil, and it's now used in Brazilian sambas and capoeira.
Okay.
And stuff, and it's a great instrument, man. And
okay.
What I want you to do is play quarter notes, and I'll show you here.
All right. So how do you play them? Oh. Okay.
All right. Now, this instrument is a shekere. This is an African-born instrument, and it's used in several countries around Africa today. It's a very spiritual instrument, and it's passed down through the family of drummers, and a lot of master drummers don't want other people touching their instruments, so this is a very sacred instrument. Now, Nicholas is going to play the quarter notes, and I'm going to try to put a 6/8 against his quarter notes.
All right.
Go ahead, Nicholas. Nicholas. Now, I had no reason for that, but just to say that I got a chance to perform with Nicholas King in studio. So, Nicholas, and it's on air, it's proven now, right?
Definitely.
The great pianist. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
All right, look, we're going to take a pause for the cause, and Nicholas actually brought a piece that we're going to play, and we're going to do something really different here today. We're going to play that piece and then come back and talk about it. So, Felicia, I think it's number 4 on there, and you can hit it whenever you can.
different.
Was there more?
Yeah.
Yeah, but it stopped.
Ah, okay, we're back. Nicholas, what piece was that?
That was Liszt's Rigoletto Paraphrase. It was based off an opera by Verdi, but transcribed for solo piano.
We were talking earlier about some of the voicings in there.
Yeah, it's really, really interesting. I mean, I enjoy it because it's an opera transcription. So there is a direct story that goes along with it, and you're able to hear all of the voices and then, you know, the fluff that Liszt threw on top of it, and it's really nice.
How does one prepare for a piece like that? Outside of practicing, we know you do that every day to get the chops and the technique and stuff together, but when you sit down to work on a piece of music,
mm-hmm.
how do you practice? Do you do it bar by bar?
Okay, are we talking about something that I haven't started before, like a brand new piece?
Yeah, exactly.
If I know about the composer, I mean, ideally what I like to do is, let's say I don't know anything about the composer,
mm-hmm.
listen to some of their other compositions, and not necessarily for solo piano, just all sorts of things. And just become familiar with their writing style, I mean, with the country that they're from, and the type of, you know, is it romantic or is it contemporary or is it impressionistic, you know, and that will really help me, even if I don't know the composer personally, you know, who would I sort of associate him with, and that will give me a lot of insight into even before I play the first note. And then when I begin working on it, there you just compartmentalize the piece, so mm-hmm. you're not working on this big, let's say 20-page piece,
right.
but you're working on a page and a half here or half a page here, and then when you break it into sections, it makes a lot more sense.
Excellent, man. I read, I guess, a couple of your Twitters, and a young lady tweeted for you. I think she asked, "Mr. King, what do I do? I get nervous before I have to go out and perform."
Right.
And I thought the advice that you gave that person was excellent.
Thank you.
You know, what you said was, if you're comfortable and done your homework on
right.
the piece, you have no reason to get nervous.
Yeah, it helps so much. I mean, I know people still, I mean, myself included, if you've done a lot of all the work that you know, you can still get nervous, but I feel that one of the things that students, one of the mistakes that students make when performing is the first time they've performed the piece will be when they walk on stage. And I think a really big thing that's helped me is practicing performing. So what I'll do if I have a concert, you know, with an orchestra or even a solo concert, anybody I went to school with will know that I'll come and bother them and I'll knock on their practice room and say, "Hey, let me play something for you." And so when I go on stage and I actually play it and I actually perform it for real, you know, I'll have performed it 20 times in the last couple of weeks. So this will just feel a bit more regular and a bit more normal.
Well, tell some of our listeners out there who are happen to maybe be working on a piece or an audition mm-hmm. about fingering, and if you see a pattern
right.
that's written out,
mm-hmm.
And you practice that piece,
right.
how do you, what about the fingering, the technique on it? I don't know if I'm explaining this right for a pianist, and you may need, say if you got a bunch of 16th notes,
okay.
and they're moving really fast,
right.
and you go into a 30-second thing, and you got to yeah. do some other stand,
right, right.
and you need to get down into the lower clef of the piano,
right?
Right? So what do? Can you cross over? I mean, you could cross and...
You can. I mean, I think it's completely dependent on the passage and completely dependent on the notes that you're playing.
Yeah.
But I mean, that I think that fingering it follows, and it isn't always so straightforward,
right.
but it follows general rules of the hand.
Right.
And if you're just aware of what's comfortable and what's natural for the hand, things will fall into place. But it's something that takes a while. And, you know, what I did when I was younger was I would just go to my teacher or I'd go to whoever was helping me, and they would just give me fingerings. And sometimes I would ask, you know, well, why would you do this here? So I my advice to them would be, you know, try and do it yourself and try mm-hmm. and figure out what your fingering would be. Then go to your teacher and ask them to review that fingering. And if they change any of it, ask them why. And then slowly you'll be able to piece together how the hand works and what sort of fingerings, you know, to lean towards and what sort of ones to stay away from.
Yeah, yeah. What about scales? And how important is it for a musician to read music?
I think it's very important. I mean, it's helped me so, so much.
Yeah.
A lot of the work that I did when I was in school, you know, to make money was accompanying. And I think that pianists are kind of fortunate in that, that they're able to be so versatile. I accompanied choirs, I accompanied singers, I accompanied classes full of singers, and it's, you know, singers are the worst with giving you music. You know, I remember there was the final exam for the Spanish diction class, and this guy walks on stage and he hands me his binder full of music, which, you know, we'd been performing all semester. Mm-hmm. And then he hands me this sheet music that I'd never seen before. This is on stage for the exam. And he said, I'm really sorry, but, you know, here it is, and it's not too hard, so you should be fine. And I had to sight read it on the spot. But I feel that the more you play and the more you read, the better you get and the quicker you're able to learn. Nobody ever said, oh, well, you know, I read way too much music, I should have cut back.
Well, I ask that, Nicholas, because I'm very concerned where the music is going today. Mm-hmm. And I'm afraid that we're getting away from traditional playing of music. And I don't really have a problem with the new stuff. I like a lot of it. But
Are you talking about like compositionally or just performance practice?
Just performance practice, composition, being able, your business and our business, it's the same. We're both in the music business, but I'm coming in more from a Broadway theater thing, and you have to know how to read to come in.
Right.
Right? But I'm concerned that the digital age with Pro Tools and Logic and making all these sounds and all the sample sounds, we're getting away from actually doing music.
Right.
You could write a treble clef and a bass clef, and these people cannot tell you what that is.
Right.
You know, which is not such a bad thing, mm-hmm. because a lot of times they spend more hours on the digital stuff and learning Pro Tools and how to do that. But I was just saying, if you knew music and you knew theory, mm-hmm. how far you could take the whole digital thing.
Right, definitely.
You know what I mean?
Definitely.
If you understand the textures, I'm listening to you play, and you're coming in and out, and it's such a sensitive position. And when you listen to a track now that's on a drum machine, mm-hmm. it's all that one level. There's no sensitivity in it.
Right.
A lot of times when I'm recording records, mm-hmm. you know, I'll go into a session. Nowadays, I'll go into a session, and they'll just have you play 4 or 5 bars, and they'll loop it. I said, no, we'll start the track at the top, and let me play it all the way through, because you build the track.
Of course.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Maybe you change a little groove right here for that, and
right.
you're playing off of each other, mm-hmm. you know. And I think we're getting away from that with musicians. When I came up in the club scene, so it was very important that we play together. You can listen to each other,
right.
play. It's jazz, you know.
Right.
That's what I do. I mean, that's my forte from playing. So I just wanted to bring that and get your thoughts on that. That's me raving on. Yeah. So in college, you know, we had all these rules and stuff with music, no parallel fifths and crossing, all this stuff, and I'm going like, well, I got in the real world, that stuff didn't matter, you know?
Right. Well, I think I'm going to be really cautious when I say this, but I feel like school.
Please be cautious.
it's definitely necessary. You have to go and you learn so much, but. I mean, I think it was, you know what I'll do is I'll quote someone else. Right. Mark Twain said, never let schooling get in the way of your education, which I think is great.
Right.
I mean, I learned so much from school, and I think it's necessary. However, the application of it in the real world, I think you're absolutely right, it rarely, you know, comes across mm-hmm. with some of the courses that you have to take. I think it's important when you're in school to learn as much as you can and read as much as you can and do everything you can, because, again, like, no one ever finishes school and said, wow, I really wish I didn't learn so much, you know, I should have cut back a bit. But after you get out of it, you know, you realize that you have to experiment a lot, and not everything is so black and white. Mm-hmm. And through that experimentation process, you're able to find your own voice and, you know, find really what works for you.
Well, speaking of black and white, what's your opinion on the weight of keys on the piano? Like, do you, well, better yet, what piano do you prefer? Do you have an endorsement?
No. Right now I'm practicing actually on an upright piano that we rented, and it's sitting in my garage.
Really?
So it's not very glamorous at all.
How about the action on something like that? Doesn't that get in the way?
It's not great. But you know what? I gave a concert. I know that pianists, especially classical pianists, are so finicky about pianos. And,
right.
you know, they really want this piano or that piano, and they need to have this whole ritual before they perform. And I kind of used to be like that, too. But when I was 17, I played with an orchestra here in L.A. And I'd played with him before, and it, you know, it went well. And the second performance, I assumed, would be like the first. It was in a church, and they rented a big, beautiful 9-foot piano. So it was the same church, and I assumed they would rent the same piano. And so I get there for the rehearsal, and it's the church piano, which I expected, because just a small, baby grand, you know, like 4.5-foot, no-name, you know, off-brand piano, which is fine for the rehearsal, kind of. But the day of the concert, I showed up, and I didn't see, you know, the big piano. And I asked them where it was, and they said, oh, sorry, we forgot to tell you. We weren't able to rent the big piano, so we're going to have you perform this concerto as a soloist on the small little baby grand. And I said, well, that doesn't make any sense. I mean, the balance is going to be off. This is a terrible no-name piano. They're like, yeah, yeah, it's okay, but we had it tuned. So so I couldn't really get out of that. And at first, I was kind of upset. But that experience of performing on a not very good piano really, I think, helped me grow, especially in the third movement when I looked down and I saw that there were ants on the keys. You know, really? And after that, I decided that, you know, I'm going to, when Disney Hall, it was the best, one of the best pianos I've ever played on.
What's in there, Steinway?
Yeah, they have a few.
Really?
Yeah, you can choose.
No kidding.
Yeah, they had, I think there were two or three Steinways, and they said, you know, go try them out and see which one you like. And I said, okay. It was like a kid in a candy shop.
What is it, the D9?
It's a Steinway D. I don't know about the numbers after them. There might be. I'm not so well-versed. But I know Steinway has, there are ones that are made in New York and ones that are made in Hamburg, Germany. And I love the ones from Hamburg, Germany. I mean, it's such a treat.
Because of the wood.
I think that might be what it is.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. What wood is that they use there, you know?
Ooh, I don't. I just know that every time I see a nice piano, it's just like cry a little bit inside.
See, I asked that because my conga drums.
Yeah.
Yeah. I was endorsing a company out of Germany, Meinl, and these drums were made from cognac barrels that they
really
would import from France, you know. And,
right.
And it was, what is it, the Black Forest or something?
I think so.
Yeah. But anyway, the wood made such a difference that when you play, man, you can hear it in
Definitely.
The room. We were talking earlier about the sound coming off the back wall and just the warm sense of playing. And
right.
You kind of get that, ugh.
It's so nice.
Yeah, baby, you know? but let's go back to this. I noticed in your YouTube video, when you approach the piano, how important is posture for playing?
While you're performing,
while you're practicing? I mean,
I think it's so important. I mean, I'm assuming it's the same with percussionists. I mean, we practice so many hours during the day that if your posture is a little bit off, it will have it'll be magnified, you know, to the extreme. And I know so many people who have had injuries and problems with their backs and their necks and their shoulders and their arms, and so many things can happen to you physically that are very, very negative simply because of your posture. But aside from that, I mean, I remember one of my first lessons in Toronto. I was sitting and I was playing, and my teacher just put his finger on my forehead and pushed my head back.
Really?
And making me not lean over the keyboard made it so much easier for me to play, and technically things became easier. So I think posture can have a really big, really, really big part of how you play.
Are you composing?
No. No, I don't.
You're not?
No.
How about conducting?
No.
What's the plans for Nicholas King later?
What I'd like to do is, I'm in a kind of unusual situation. The school that I graduated from in Toronto, it's a fantastic school. However, they recently broke off from the University of Toronto, and now they're a standalone school. It's the Royal Conservatory of Music, and that's kind of the umbrella. And within that, I went to the Glenn Gould School, which is the conservatory. They offer 4-year and 2-year diplomas. But they're just that, diplomas. They aren't degrees because the school doesn't right now. I think down the line they will offer them. But I graduated with a 4-year diploma, but it's not a bachelor's of music. They're affiliated with an online school, which is also in Canada, but I'd have to submit a separate application. And since I'm international, you know, pay a lot to take a few online classes to technically get my bachelor's of music. So actually this Friday I have an audition in San Francisco for the San Francisco Conservatory of Music. What I'm hoping to do is go there and finish my bachelor's degree and then I'll go and obtain my master's, and, you know, while doing that, perform as much as I can and do as many competitions as I can. But the other thing that I'm really excited about is a nonprofit organization that I just started, The Art of Giving Back.
Yeah.
And I think that, I mean, is what I really want to put the majority of my time and focus into, because I think it could be a really, really big thing.
Well, we're going to get back to that, because I definitely have a few questions about The Art of Giving Back and some of your other supporters as well and your events coming up. But you mentioned going into San Francisco, young listeners, Harlem, how would they prepare for an audition, something that big? Do you have a piece in mind? Can you say what piece you're going to play?
Sure, sure. Yeah? Well, it's going to be a couple. I mean, usually for college auditions, it's pretty standard no matter where you go.
Mm-hmm.
They're going to ask for a Baroque piece, a classical piece, a romantic piece, sometimes an extra piece, and then a contemporary piece.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm doing a Bach transcription. It's by Bach, but transcribed by Busoni, a prelude by Bach. I'm going to do a sonata by Haydn, so that's the classical. I'm doing the Liszt Rigoletto paraphrase that we heard just a little while ago.
Really?
I'm playing that.
Yeah.
I'm playing a piece by Mili Balakirev, a Russian composer, a big virtuosic piece, Islame. And then I'm doing a contemporary piece by a Canadian composer, Francois Morel. So in preparation for it, my recommendation would be first pick out a balanced program that makes sense, something that isn't all too slow or all too fast, that really showcases a lot of variety. But also pick pieces that you're very comfortable with. And then perform them as much as you can. So, I mean, the Rigoletto I've been playing for years, and I feel very comfortable performing that. So going and doing this audition, I don't feel particularly nervous about that piece or really any of them, because I feel like, again, what I was talking about before is practicing performing. I think it's really important. When I was younger, if I had something coming up, I would practice, and kind of cram the few weeks before, and then to get it ready by that date. But ideally, I think for something extremely important, you want it ready months before.
Yeah.
And you want it ready to perform months before, and then you can just sit and relax, and then you feel so comfortable in it when you have to actually go and do it for real.
Nicholas, has any record companies approached you about signing a deal?
No, not yet.
Have you pursued it?
No, not yet. I graduated in May, and especially during my last year, it was such a whirlwind. And this summer, I've been traveling all around with competitions and concerts that I haven't really had the opportunity, but it's something that I plan on exploring, this upcoming year, since I have a little bit of time off school.
Oh, you should.
Yeah.
You really should. And it would be great, man, when you get your thing going and you come back down to L.A., and I would love to do some work with you, do some percussion piece and have you come and play something on
top
of it.
That'd be great, yeah.
Would you be open for that?
So, yeah, definitely.
I could write something for that. That would be great, man.
That'd be so much fun.
Now, you said earlier that you you were doing some light improv over at Hamilton High.
So, I mean, it was so beyond basic.
Yeah.
I remember my first, I thought it would be fun, so I signed up for the jazz band, and since I knew I never played any jazz, I was in the bottom one, the beginner one. And it was a big band, and the conductor, he gave me the score, and we started, and we played, about halfway through, and then he stopped, and he came over to me, and he said, "What are you doing?" And I said, "Well, I'm trying to sight read it. I'm sorry, I'm not the best sight reader, but I'm doing my best." He said, no, that's fine, but why are you playing all the notes on the page?" And I said, "I'm sorry, I don't understand. I mean, they're on the page. That's what you're supposed to do." He said, no, you play around the notes. Yeah. And that whole concept was so new for me. So
you, the chart that he gave you actually had notes on it?
Mm-hmm.
And it didn't have chord progressions, like we write out
I know.
A G triangle and a 7, a
right.
G major 7, and
right.
You put four slashes down there.
Right.
So you didn't have anything like that. You had the
whole chord. We had actual notes. Then above it, we had the chord progressions as well. So
uh-huh.
If you weren't a beginner like me, you were able to sort of embellish on top of it and just kind of use that as a guidepost. But as we did more advanced pieces or songs, it shifted to scores like that.
Yeah. So if I asked you to do that, you wouldn't have a problem reading that.
No. I mean, it's something that I picked up in university. We had to do a keyboard harmony class, and we covered that.
And most musicians and panel players I know, I know a few around town. There's no way they could do what you do. I mean, I tried to get a couple down just to watch this interview, but I'm sure they're watching it at home now, man, because, as you listen to the piece that we just heard, it's just so smooth and clean.
Thank you.
I love that.
Well, I think it's great, and musicians that I've talked to who aren't, let's say, primarily classical musicians,
uh-huh.
They say it's such a benefit, even if that's not what you want to focus on, to do a little bit of it.
Oh, you have to.
I think so.
That's technique.
Yeah.
Nicholas, I mean, it's just, you get around the keyboard better. That's why I was asking about crossing over
right.
And stuff and certain scales and stuff like that.
I mean,
that.
I knew a dancer who said the same thing about ballet. I mean, she didn't focus on ballet primarily. She liked more hip-hop and contemporary.
Mm-hmm.
But she said to go and do ballet every now and then really, really helped as sort of a center.
Yeah. Okay, well, let's go back to your The Art of Giving Back. I want to talk about the the nonprofits that you're involved in and some of your fundraisers, because I know that you've been involved in raising money for, you raised money for Los Angeles Children's Hospital, right?
Right.
Was that a while back or recently?
The Children's Hospital was a while back. It was from, what was it, 1997 to 2000.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
$35,000?
Right.
You ought to come over and raise some money for us. That's a lot, man. Congratulations.
Thank you.
You want to talk about this, The Art of Giving Back?
Sure. You know, it came out of, I made a small comment while I was in the kitchen this summer that my, you know, my parents, they heard and they asked me about it, and it kind of blossomed into this idea. And I'd say, you know, it was initially my idea, but without their support, it wouldn't have become what it is now. The whole concept behind it is young musicians that are around my age, you mm-hmm. know, in university or having just finished university, helping other young musicians who have recently done what, you know, or who are currently going through what we just experienced. Because I feel like there's a bit of a gap, you know. My current teacher, he's in his 60s, and although he's so well versed in so many aspects of the music business and, you know, practicing and technique, it's been a while since he's been 22. Right. And struggled with, you know, what people who are 22, who are 18, who are 16 are struggling. That's he's kind of far removed from that, and I'm not. You know, I remember it, and I'm going through it right now.
Mm-hmm.
So the whole concept of it are people my age and who have kind of done what I've done, going back and helping kids who are currently auditioning for conservatories for their undergrad, or who might be in middle school and considering pursuing a career in music, but they don't really know because it's so ambiguous. And if you don't grow up in a family of musicians, you can be so lost. So kind of just be a voice to help them out a bit.
You are absolutely right.
Yeah.
I mean, because you find so many kids starting on music and they want to play an instrument, and
right.
then on the way up, they lose track, whether they get bored with the practicing or
right.
whatever, just get digitized and,
yeah.
and cool and whatever.
Well,
know?
I mean, I constantly think that the only reason I'm here is because of other people. And I mean, aside from my private teachers who have helped me immensely, there have always been people who have inspired me or mentored me in some way. And without their support and without my parents' support, it wouldn't even be possible for me to be here. So I'd like to kind of just be a support for some kid, because maybe the extra push is all they need in order to do something great. You know, and if we can give back just a little bit, I really think it could help so many people and not take so much effort.
And that's one reason I do this show,
mm-hmm.
to expose some of the people that we talked about that off air. Well, what actually goes on in the entertainment business, you know?
Right. I think it's important.
Yeah, very important. How about the Kickstarter program?
The Kickstarter. One of the interesting things about being a classical musician is that you learn how to make money in non-traditional ways, and I've done everything from selling donuts to giving concerts in people's houses to playing at a church to, you know, all sorts of things, and I needed money.
Yeah.
I needed money to go specifically to Spain. Mm-hmm. I went to Spain in August for a music festival, and I stayed with a few teachers, and I played
what
around.
What city did you go in?
Gijón.
Really?
Yeah. So I think it's about I could be wrong, but I think it's about 2 hours away from Madrid.
Yeah.
And it's beautiful. It was so, so nice there. I had a lot of fun. We went swimming in the ocean at 4 a.m.
Yeah.
Yeah. But we did a lot of playing too. There was serious work, but I needed money to go. I mean, in the height of the season, it's so expensive to fly and pay for an apartment and pay for the festival itself. So I heard about Kickstarter. I was fortunate enough, the host family I was living with in Toronto, their son does video editing.
Uh-huh.
And I told him I wanted to do a Kickstarter program, and I asked him if he knew anybody that could help me make a video. He knew a director, and they were kind enough to do it completely for free. So
yeah.
We rented out time in my school, and we put together a little 2 or 3 minute video of me just really playing and explaining what I needed the funds for. And then the way the Kickstarter worked was if somebody gave, I think, $10, they got a CD.
Mm-hmm.
If they gave $25, they got a CD and a poster. And it went up incrementally from there. And we sent it to everybody that we knew. And I was able to make enough money to go. You know, people were very, very generous. And that's how I was able to fund my trip to Spain.
Yeah, let me tell you a quick story. I'm going to share this with you because you brought up Spain. It's so funny. I've been over a few times, went to Valencia, Madrid, and once I went over with these rappers, and you know the food, people like to eat late at night over there,
right?
And you know, I'm going like, man, we're in Spain. Let's get out and see what's going on. The Moors, all this history and stuff going on here, man. These guys want to go up. Knuckleheads want to eat at McDonald's and Pizza Hut, man. You know, so I thought about that. It was just so funny to me, man. But anyway, you have some upcoming events?
I do. I'm going. Well, right now it's a little tricky because I'm in a transition. I mean, having just come out of school and not really being in school, in order, what I did was this summer, as I emailed all of the music schools in California, mm-hmm. and I said, "Hi, I'm Nicholas King. I'm a pianist, and I'm looking to finish my degree. And you know, if any of you could help me, that'd be really great." And the one that seemed to work out was San Francisco. So I'm kind of in between as far as that's concerned. I have a few concerts lined up in Toronto, but that isn't so probably pertinent to maybe the people that are listening right now. I've done a lot of work with the Southeast Symphony Orchestra. It's a great smaller orchestra based here in Los Angeles. And I'll be performing with them this season. I've spoke with a conductor a few days ago, and we haven't worked out any exact dates or pieces, but the information will be up on my website in the next couple of days. And I spoke with the director a few weeks ago, and it's my understanding that I'll be coming back for every season after that.
Right.
So I'll be around with the Southeast Symphony.
And you're doing a lot of chamber music as well, right?
Not as much. Uh-huh. No, I mean, I primarily either play solo concerts or I perform as a soloist with an orchestra.
Well, have you talked to anyone downtown at our music center?
At the Colburn School?
No, at the Disney Hall.
Oh, any of the LA Film Musicians?
Yeah.
No, I again,
Gustavo.
Like, I mean, one of the difficulties is that I spent 4 years, even though it's Canada, in another country, and I made contacts that are so far removed from here. So, I mean, having just kind of relocated back to Southern California, I'm kind of trying to reestablish my old concerts contacts and
yeah.
make new ones.
Yeah. Well, I got to tell you, Nicholas, thank you for being on the show today.
Thank you.
And making that long trip and almost doing a 360 here. Thank you, my man, and good luck to you.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
In San Francisco.
Hey, one thing I just wanted to point out to anybody that's listening, because you were asking about the young artist, if I had any advice.
Oh, yeah.
On the Art of Giving Back website, which is just artofgivingback.org, mm-hmm. there's a young artist forum, and that's what you read about when the girl asked about when she gets nervous or when their hands get sweaty.
Right.
And on there, anyone is able to post a question about anything, any aspect of performing or practicing. And then I have a few musicians that have volunteered for it. So we have a list of volunteer artists that are all over the world. We have some singers, we have a harpist, we have other pianists, we have a violinist, we have a cellist. And we answer any of those questions, you know, as best we can, and usually within the same day. So if anyone wants to go, it's just artofgivingback.org, and they're able to see the Young Artist Forum and ask any questions they'd like.
Also, folks, it's NicholasKingPiano.com as well, right?
Right, that's my personal website.
That's a great website, by
thank
the
you.
Way. Yeah, good. Well, thank you, my man.
Thank you. Thank you for having
thank
me.
Thank you for sharing your music and your wonderful life story at only 21. You got a long ways to go, dude.
Thank you.
Yes. Thank you, Felicia. You're listening to Eric McCain live only on the RMConAir.com. We'll be back next Sunday. Nicholas King. Nicholas King, we've had Nicholas King on the show today as our concert pianist, and thank you once again, Nicholas.
Thank you for having me.
Eric McCain live on the RMConAir.com. We'll be back next Sunday, 5 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. Thank you.